hiccup and the RNFL defect, if you are familiar with that. In the large disc, you know, obviously the cup is very big, and erroneously you may diagnose the patient having a trachoma. You should be able to pick up the other characteristic features of the glaucoma, like the notching of the disc, the bearing of the blood vessels. You know, if you are seeing the disc serially, and if you have documented that this vessel has bared, it's a very good indicator that the patients have a glaucoma. Otherwise, the bearing of the vessels is a pretty common thing which you may have in your practice. You have to see the appearance of the disc hemorrhage. Most of the patient, if they are progressing, then they would have the disc hemorrhage, and then subsequently the disc hemorrhage will disappear and you will have a significant RNFL defect over there. You have to see the parapapillary atrophy, and you must know how to differentiate the glaucomatous parapapillary atrophy with the aging parapapillary atrophy or a myopic parapapillary atrophy. It always correlates with the notching of the disc. Then it is obviously a classical glaucomatous parapapillary atrophy. Obviously, you have to see the red with the red free light, because once you see with the red free light, you can see you can visualize the superficial layer of the retina very well, because the superficial layers of the retina require a light with a laser wavelength, and the green light is with a laser wavelength. So you can visualize the RNFL very well with the red free light. So always in your practice, start seeing that and differentiate the glaucomatous disc with the congenital disc anomalies, which includes the coloboma and the optic nerve pit. For the angle closure glaucoma, yes, the von Herricks is a good method. So you can pick up the angle closure suspect by doing the von Herricks, but there is no substitute of the gonioscopy. And the flash torch light test could be a test of your choice in a remote practice, but it's not a very good clinical indicator. You know, when you have a flat iris and you throw a torch light perpendicular over the iris, then you can very well visualize the lights on the other quadrant of the iris. But if the contour of the iris is convex, then obviously you would be seeing the shadow on the other side, and that is an indicator that the patients probably the suspect. So yes, in the remote area as well, with the limited resources, you would be able to pick up both the primary glaucomas, the angle closer, as well as the open angle glaucoma. But to confirm the diagnosis and to do a follow-up, you need a little more resources at your disposal. That includes the gonioscope, that includes the perimeter. Thank you very much for your patience hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep. I think we'll take questions at the end. There is a panel discussion, so keep your thoughts ready. And I now invite Dr. Harsh. He's talk about having a confirmed case of glaucoma and how do you proceed to treat. Dr. Harsh needs no introduction. He's a leading specialist in glaucoma over a long, long, long period of time, practicing in Delhi.
Thank you, Shishmita. I think so, glaucoma is proven, Prateep, and with whatever limited resources we had, you have checked the disc, you have found a notch over there, you have correlated with the perimetry. Yes, the notch is inferior, the field effect is superior, so you are pretty much dealing with glaucoma. You have done a gonioscopy to find out what type of glaucoma it is. Like I said in the beginning itself, spend 5 to 10 minutes with each new patient, please. That is critical, because that is the time when you make a rapport, find out where the patient comes from, how many kids he has, how many ailing parents he has in the home, what is going on with the home, so that you know whom are you treating. Unless you know whom you are treating, you are like to default in so many other things. And obviously, you have to give him an explanation of what you are trying to do with him. Like we said, you have to show him the basic things. And so, like Prateep said, yes, despite all this, you should have a disc photo, you should have a visual field, even you have to send the patient somewhere around. You have to do an IOP, and please get into the habit of doing intraocular pressure 3-4 times in a day and not just once in a day. Gonioscopy is a must. Corneal thickness at least once you will have to do. And imaging sometimes may be required, and we'll see in ocular hypertension where it is required. Pachymetry, we keep telling, yes, pachymetry is important. The only important thing you must remember is thinner the corneas, you have to be aggressive in your approach. These are the people who will progress faster, and you are under recording their pressures. But as far as thick corneas are concerned, I'll show you a case that I had. And this was a patient who came to me, a one-eyed patient, disc field absolutely normal. Diurnal variation was somewhere around 20 to 24, and the corneal thickness was 620. So I said, this is fine, yaar, we'll not treat. Let it be. 1 year down the line, the patient came to me, and suddenly I realized, though the field was normal, you see such a nice wedge is appearing first. And I said, what the hell happened here? It was thick corneas. I was always taught not to treat this. And then we did a pre-perimetric thing, and you can see OCT, which was normal, has now developed changes. And when we went back and read, and we found that, all right, this knowledge was already there. Parks had said that if you neglect thick corneas in checking this out, you can lead into problems. So please be careful. If it's a thick cornea, don't sit on it. Don't think that, okay, I'm not going to treat it. All right, you may not treat it, but be very, very careful and follow them regularly still, because there could be a problem. Doing a diurnal variation is very important, because it will tell you where the pressures are coming. And we want to flatten our diurnal variation. So it's not only that we are trying to see that, okay, we must achieve a mean pressure, but the mean pressure should be there all the time. So that the diurnal variation, if it is less than 3 or 4, we are very, very good with us. So who's the patient I am treating? What glaucoma is it? And which medicine should I start with? And please, so many people don't even bother. They just write and send off the patient. You have to tell the patient, all right, if you come to me every 2 to 3 months, get a pressure done. Every 6 to 9 months, get a field done. And we'll keep working on this together. And I promise to you, you will never go blind. This word you must tell them. Because you will not tell no, but they are so shattered when you have a disease like that. They go to the net and they say, oh, you'll go blind in 5 years. What nonsense. But and they are really shattered. So you have to sit down, you have to counsel them that you will take care of them. And that way, not only you will do a great justice to the patient, but to yourself, because the patient is going to stick to you. So we have to decide how low should I keep my intraocular pressure. By and large, if the fields and discs are pretty much okay, you can be okay with keeping the pressure less than 21. If it is a moderate damage, around 14 to 16 should be our first call. And if it is very advanced damage, maybe we should keep our pressures less than 12. But this was the initial pressure. That is the first medication we want to bring down the pressure. Then you do serial follow-up with fields. But field is going to be done after 3 to 6 months. So you do a diurnal control and check that whether you have actually achieved the pressure at all point times what you wanted. So yes, now I've done 4 or 5 pressures in a day, and they are all coming at around 12 to 14. That's what I wanted. If it is not, then you increase your medication or change your medication. And then if the fields are getting worse, that means that despite the pressure being normal, this was not the right pressure. So if the fields are still getting worse, you have 2 baseline fields. And the next time you do the field, you find that the fields have got worse. You lower the pressure from what you have initially kept it as. And that would be our final target pressure. But that will keep changing while you are doing fields. So what is the first medicine I should start with? Obviously, the first medicine is prostaglandin analogs, if the patient can afford. That's what I said. You have to sit with the patient and find out where he comes from, because they will never say no to you, but they will never put the medicine also. So our purpose is totally defeated. Whole lot of India is still using beta blockers, and there's nothing wrong with it at all. So if you feel that the patient will not afford, you can use beta blockers. In the normal tension glaucoma study done abroad, pilocarpine was the drug used. So please remember, these are the cheap drugs of our country, and you can still use them easily. But obviously, we prefer prostaglandin analogs, because once only we have to put it, it has the maximum pressure lowering. If that doesn't work, you can add on a beta blocker to that, or use dorzolamide, brinzolamide, or brimonidine as an addition. The moment you add on 2 to 3 drugs, tell in the mind of the patient that maybe later we'll have to do surgery, because there are too many medications, he'll not put them properly, and it's going to be a mess. So if the pressure is around 20 to 30 millimeters to begin with, you can start with one medication, PJ analog, or a beta blocker. Check in 3 weeks whether the pressure has come down to a significant level. If the pressure is less than 15 to 20% of drop, that means that medicine is not acting, change the medicine. Either change the brand or change the medicine altogether. And if the pressure is dropping, but it is not dropping to the level you want, but it is at least more than 20%, you can always add another medication. If IOP is greater than 30, then you may actually even start with one or two medications. If the disc is, especially if the disc is compromised, when it's a 0.8, 0.9 disc, fields are having changes, don't wait for one drug, you can give two drugs. If the pressure is more than 40, you can even start with oral